بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. صلى الله عليك يا مولاي يا رسول الله، صلى الله عليك يا سيدي ومولاي يا حبيب الله، صلى الله عليك وعلى أهل بيتك الطيبين الطاهرين، لا سيما ولدك الحسن بن علي الشهيد المسموم، لعن الله الظالمين لكم من الأولين والآخرين. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم: الحسن والحسين سيدا شباب أهل الجنة. صدق رسول الله. صل على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. On 7th of Safar, according to some of the narrations, it is the martyrdom of Imam al-Hasan salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayh. The other riwayah is on 28th or 29th of Safar, at end of Safar. It was in the year 50 after Hijrah. Imam Hassan alayhi salam was born on the third year of Hijrah, and he was very much loved by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. He and his brother Imam Hussein, and the Holy Prophet used to show their greatness in front of the people. And that means not only because they are his grandsons, but he wants to tell the Muslims about their peculiarity, that they are not like other children, and they have a great position among the Muslims. That is why from their childhood, the Holy Prophet used to say that Al-Hasan wal-Husayn Sayyida Shababi Ahlil Jannah. Hasan and Hussein are masters of the youth of paradise. And also he used to say, Al-Hasan wal-Husayn imaman qama aw qa'ada. Hasan and Hussein both are imams, whether they stand or they sit. And that probably a hint that Imam Hassan will be forced to have a peace treaty with Muawiyah and will sit, and Imam Hussein will be forced to take a stand and will be martyred in Karbala. So he says, at any position, whether they stand or sit, in both cases they are imams. Because imamate is a position given to the imam by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not elected by people. So when the Holy Prophet say they are imams, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appointed them as imams. Whether imam is sitting at home or is leading the people as a leader, as a governor, as a caliph, or he is in jail, at any position, he is still imam of the mankind. So the Holy Prophet used to tell that they are imams, whether they stand or whether they sit. Means they know their religious duty, when to stand and when to sit. Well, also we see that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he gathered them under the kisa, under the mantle, the cover, and then the ayah, innama yuridu Allah liyudhhiba ankum ar-rijsa ahli al-bayt wa yutahhirakum tathira. Surely Allah want to take away from you the sins or the dirt from you, O Ahlul Bayt, and purify you, high purification. One of them of Ahlul Bayt was Imam Hassan alayhi salam. Because the Holy Prophet put a cover, like a blanket, like something like that. And then he said that, O Allah, they are my household. And under that was Imam Ali, Fatima Zahra, Hassan and Hussein, and the Prophet himself. And then the ayah came that Allah is taking away of you the sins and the dirt and the filthy things, rites, and purify you high purification. See, Imam Hassan was included in that. And at time of Nasara Najran, the Christians from city of Najran, when they came and they have argument with the Prophet about Jesus, whether he is son of God or he is messenger of God, as the Muslims believe, and then the Holy Prophet has great discussion with them, is mentioned, a lot of discussions. Ultimately, they rejected that, and then the ayah came that if they do not accept that, do mubahala. Mubahala means to pray to God to curse whoever is a liar among them. So the Holy Prophet asked them for mubahala, and next day when the Prophet came to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, did not bring anyone of the Muslims, and he brought only his household, means Imam Ali, Fatima Zahra, and Hassan and Hussein. And it is mentioned that Imam Hassan was a child, his hand is in hand of the Prophet, and the Holy Prophet used to carry Imam Hussein. And then behind them, Fatima Zahra, and behind her is Imam Ali alayhi salam. That was the shape of Wahla. And when the head of the Christians, the priest, saw the Holy Prophet came with his household, he said, I look to these faces, they are so, let us say, sacred and holy faces. If they ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remove a mountain from its place, Allah will remove the mountain for their sake. So don't accept mubahala with them, otherwise none of the Christians would have remained alive and go to peace with them without mubahala. And then they said, no, we will not do mubahala, and they had peace treaty with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So what I mean, Imam Hassan alayhi salam was always with the Holy Prophet in the critical and special situations. And there the Holy Quran said to the Prophet that if the Christians of Najran refuse the facts you have said about Jesus, that he is a messenger of Allah, not son of God, then call your Abna, your sons, your children. And the Prophet did not come with any one of the children of the Muslims except with Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein. So though they were his grandchildren, they were sons of his daughter, but the Holy Quran called them directly, they are children of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then about Imam Ali, say anfusana, our souls. So he's speaking about Imam Ali, he is like soul of the Prophet. And then nisa'ana, our women, only Fatima Zahra was there. So the best of the women were Fatima Zahra salamullahi alayha, and the Holy Prophet brought her for that critical situation of praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So from that is a proof that they are sons of the Prophet, because in the old time and even nowadays, many people said, why do you say about Sayyids who are descendant of Imam Hassan or descendant of Imam Hussein, they are from the descendants of the Prophet. They are not descendants of the Prophet, they are descendants of Imam Ali, because they are sons of Fatima Zahra and Imam Ali. So we say the answer, Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein, though they are sons of Imam Ali and sons of Fatima Zahra, but the Holy Quran says they are sons of the Prophet. And the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself said that every Prophet, his progeny are from himself, from his back, the word, except me, my progeny are from Ali. So my progeny, this is, my children are sons of Ali, means sons of my daughter Fatima Zahra salamullahi alayha. And the Holy Quran clearly here says the wa abna'ana, and our sons, and our sons were only Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein alayhim as-salam. However, Imam Hassan lived all that life with his grandfather, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and after death of the Prophet in the 10th year of Hijrah, age of Imam Hussein was about 7 years, 7.5 years. And after that, he faced all the sufferings of his mother, Fatima al-Zahra, salamullahi alayha, till martyrdom of Fatima al-Zahra, about 3 months after the death of the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then Imam Hassan also faced the difficult time his father, Imam Ali alayhi salam, lived when the Khilafah was usurped, and Imam Ali was 25 years at home, and the government is in hand of others, you know. Till the people came after killing of Uthman and pledge allegiance with Imam Ali alayhi salam, did bay'at, and Imam Ali become the Imam. I mean, Imam actively in the government, otherwise he is Imam even when he was at home or was silent, he is Imam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has appointed him as Imam. Then at time of about 4.5-5 years, the government of Imam Ali alayhi salam, or Khilafat of Imam Ali alayhi salam, then there were three great wars. One of them, the Battle of Kamel, Harbul Jamal, where Talha and Zubair and Aisha, they came from Mecca, Aisha, and then Medina. Talha and Zubair were in Medina, they went to Mecca, and then they came to Basra and have a great army against Imam Ali alayhi salam. Because Talha and Zubair, they were with Imam Ali alayhi salam at time of six people who were appointed by Umar. He said, these six people, if three are in one side and three are in the other side, so the three where Abdurrahman ibn Auf is there, then he will be the caliph. Well, Abdurrahman ibn Auf and Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas and Uthman were in one side. Naturally, they were relatives to Uthman. They appointed Uthman. Talha and Zubair and Imam Ali. Talha and Zubair were with Imam Ali. They said, no, we appoint Imam Ali as caliph. But then, according to will of Umar, then Uthman become the caliph. So Talha and Zubair were, especially Zubair, who was cousin of Imam Ali. He was with Imam Ali always. And even at time of Saqifa, when they attacked house of Imam Ali alayhi salam, and Fatima al-Zahra was injured, then Zubair was in house of Imam Ali alayhi salam. He was supporting Imam Ali, and he refused to do bay'at with Abu Bakr. So in all those days, Zubair were with Imam Ali. Now that Imam Ali become the governor of the Muslim countries, the caliph, then they came and they said, okay, let us be the leader of Basra, and the other one said, let me be the leader of Kufa. So they want to be the governor of Basra and governor of Kufa. Imam Ali refused to give them that. So they got very angry that, oh, what have we got after all that? You know, now that the government is in your hand, you are not giving us any favor. Imam Ali knew their intention was not 100% for sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, though apparently they were with him, but inside it was not purely for sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for any other reason. When he refused, they said, okay, there's no point that we remain with Imam Ali, we are not going to get any benefit. So they came and asked Imam Ali, we want to go for Umrah from Medina to Mecca. Imam Ali said, you are not going for Umrah. You are going for a treachery, because you have a plan in your mind. They said, no, by Allah, we are going for Umrah only. And he said, okay, pledge allegiance again. Do bay'at second time. Because first they did bay'at. Now, a second bay'at they did with Imam Ali, that you are our Imam. And when they came to Mecca, Aisha also was not willing that to see Imam Ali to be the caliph. She was thinking that Talha will be the caliph after Uthman, not Imam Ali. So they, together, all the three, they made a plan and they said, okay, we'll take a stand against Imam Ali. And they moved from Mecca to Basra. In Basra, they had many followers. And there was a governor of Basra, Uthman ibn Hunayf, on behalf of Imam Ali, has sent him. They actually took his hair one by one, you know, by hand. He was an elderly man, and his beard were taken completely out, and they beaten him and throw him away, and they killed a lot of people and took over Basra. Then Imam Ali was forced to have an army to fight with them. Then he moved from Medina to Kufa. Kufa had big number of population. Medina, not many population were there, but Kufa, because it is agricultural area and there is a big river there. So naturally in agricultural area, people can live a better life. So that is why it has a great population. And Imam Ali moved to Kufa. The governor in Kufa, he was not in favor of supporting Imam Ali, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari. Then Imam Ali sent his son, Imam Hassan, to encourage the people to come to the army and support Imam Ali alayhi salam. While Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, he looks apparently a religious man, so people respect him. But what religious man when he do not support Imam of his time? You know, people look apparently to him and they think he is right, and Imam Ali, the real Imam, he is not right. He said, well, O people, the Prophet said, if there are any turmoil among Muslims, you be quiet, you be away. If there are problems, people are fighting, you know, you don't fight, don't support anyone. And now I don't know, Ali and Talha, Zubair, they are fighting, so you be away, you be safe. So he was discouraging people from supporting Imam Ali alayhi salam. That is why Imam Ali sent Imam Hassan alayhi salam and Malik al-Ashtar, and they encouraged the people to come and fight, and they supported Imam Ali. Well, it is mentioned about the bravery of Imam Hassan alayhi salam, because some historians say that Imam Hassan was not very brave. Imam Hussein was brave, that is why he took a stand in Karbala. But Imam Hassan was not brave, and he wanted to sit aside, and he likes to be in a peace and healthy and quiet peace. Well, it was not true. That is not the picture of any one of the imams, you know. All our imams were very brave, but they keep quiet for certain reasons and philosophy. Then it is mentioned here that Imam Ali alayhi salam had his two sons, Hassan and Hussein, with him, and third son, Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyya. His mother was another man, I mean, not Fatima al-Zahra, another wife. Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyya was also very brave, very strong fighter. And well, Imam Ali used to trust him and send him to fight more than Hassan and Hussein, because he asked them not to participate physically. He said that they are sons of the Prophet and they are brave. If they fight and they are killed by enemies, then the progeny of the Prophet will finish, and they need them to for continuation of generation after generation, because the progeny of the Prophet will be from Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein. And one time they asked Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyya that, aren't you son of Ali? He said, yes. So then why Ali throw you in the war and difficulties, and you might be killed in war, while your brothers Hassan and Hussein are not participating in war? He said to them, to the people, that they are his eyes and I am his hand. So he protect his eyes with his hand. It's a very nice answer. And then, because of the criticism of the people who were jealous, he came to his father and he told him, oh, my father, am I not your son? He said, yes. He said, well, Hassan and Hussein are your son. He said, yes. He said, why you put me in war always in the front to fight, and Hassan and Hussein, you are not allowing them always to fight. Imam Ali alayhi salam replied to him that you are my son. They are sons of the Prophet. So I protect sons of the Prophet by my son. And well, naturally, he was satisfied with that answer, at least to tell the people. Otherwise, he knew that very well. Still in the Battle of Camel, it was mentioned that Imam Ali alayhi salam gave the standard in hand of Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyya and told him, attack till you go and hit the camel. Because if the camel fall down, the army will disperse. And all the army was protecting the camel. On the camel was Aisha, being Ummul Mu'mineen, wife of the Prophet. So the people, as long as the camel is there, Aisha is there, they continue the fight, and thousands of people were killed. But if the camel is killed, then the people will disperse and the war will finish. So Imam Ali told his son Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyya, take the banner and attack till you reach the camel. Then when he started to attack, the people who throw arrow started throwing arrow, and naturally hundreds of arrows came. He kept quiet, waiting for the arrows of the people to finish, because if he attack from a long distance, they will hit him and hit the horses and hit his army. As a plan, he said, I will wait when their arrows finish, then I can attack. Then Imam Ali found him that he is hesitating. He told him that give me the banner. He took the banner and gave it to Imam Hassan. And he said, oh my son, go and attack. Imam Hassan did not care for the arrows. He attacked very quickly. And when he attacked quickly, in let us say 2-3 seconds, if that distance, let us say 50 yards, where the arrow they can, if he cross it, then the arrows has no effect, you know, because they will be together with the army, and then they cannot hit the arrow. They may kill their own colleagues, you know. So Imam Hassan attacked all the army, who were about 60,000 people there. He attacked them till he came to the camel and hit the camel in his eye and returned back. Then Imam Ali gave the banner to Imam Hussein and he said, go and attack. He went and attacked the camel till he hit the other eye of the camel. And then ultimately the camel fell down and the war finished. So what I mean, Imam Hassan alayhi salam and Imam Hussein were showing their bravery greatly. If they did not participate physically in many wars, because Imam Ali alayhi salam want them to remain safe for the generation of the Prophet to continue. And we see nowadays there are millions of Sayyids who are descendants of the Prophet. They are mainly descendants of Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein alayhim salam. There are Sayyid. Of course, there are some Sayyid sons of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. There are some Sayyids of sons of Hashim, but not from the Prophet, the other cousins of the Prophet. However, but the main Sayyids in the world number are descendants of Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein. That is why Imam Ali wanted to protect their life as much as he can. Well, the same thing, Imam Hassan participated in the Battle of Siffin against Muawiyah. And also he asked Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein not to fight, because you know, if they fight, they are brave, but ultimately the army will attack them and Muawiyah will try to kill them. So he protected them. However, after, let us say, a very bitter life, 4.5 or almost 5 years, life of Khilafat of Imam Ali alayhi salam, then when Amir al-Mu'minin alayhi salam were martyred by the sword of Abdurrahman ibn Muljim, then Imam Hassan alayhi salam came to the mosque and delivered a great sermon praising his father, Imam Ali alayhi salam, that he is the Khatam al-Wasiyyin and he is the greatest man after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was lost in this night, and then asked the people to do bay'at with him, and then the people, all they pledge allegiance with him, and he was the caliph among the Muslims. Now, when Muawiyah in Sham realized that Imam Hassan was elected by people as caliph, he was nominated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as an imam, however, practically, the people also accepted that. Then Muawiyah rejected that, and he threatened that he will fight with Imam Hassan and his army. There were many letters between Muawiyah and Imam Hassan. Muawiyah insisted that he will not surrender and he will bring people of Sham to attack Iraq, and then he gathered a huge army and came to Iraq. Imam Hassan alayhi salam also asked the people that Muawiyah is coming and you the people have to be prepared to fight. But then the people were not very serious in that case. They kept quiet. Nobody replied till four or five of very sincere believers, they criticized the people that the son of the Prophet is calling you to support him and now you are not replying. What people are you? And they said, we are ready to support him, and they moved from Kufa to Nukhayla. Nukhayla is near Karbala of today, about 60-65 kilometers from Kufa. And from there, gradually the army were gathered, and Imam Hassan alayhi salam moved toward north near Syria, where Muawiyah were coming by his army, initially a distance of about 1,000 kilometers, maybe more, that they have to go north, and then from Sham, Muawiyah is coming. Imam Hassan sent an army in advance with his cousin Ubaydullah ibn al-Abbas. Ubaydullah ibn al-Abbas is son of al-Abbas, Abbas son of Abdul Muttalib, son of al-Abbas, uncle of the Prophet. So naturally he is cousin to Imam Hassan alayhi salam. And then Ubaydullah ibn al-Abbas had suffered from Muawiyah because he was governor in Yemen. And then Muawiyah sent Bisr ibn Artat. He was a very cruel man, and he went and killed the people. And Ubaydullah ibn al-Abbas was afraid that he will be killed. He ran away. But then when Bisr ibn Artat came to house of Ubaydullah ibn al-Abbas and said that he has left, he found his wife and two small children for Ubaydullah. He killed the children, both of them, in front of the vision of their mother. Now, small children, were killed brutally in order to take revenge from their father, because their father ran away. So in spite of all that problems Ubaydullah ibn Abbas faced from Muawiyah and his soldier, Bisr ibn Artat, still Muawiyah, when faced the army, the first attack was in favor of Ubaydullah ibn al-Abbas, army of Imam Hassan. They could defeat the army of Muawiyah. Muawiyah sent him a letter. It is mockery. That, why are you fighting? Imam Hassan is writing me a letter. He wants to be in peace with me. So why not you come now with honor rather than you come tomorrow by force? Because if Imam Hassan signed peace treaty with me, naturally, you have to accept that as well. And well, he didn't know this is right or not. Things were secret, naturally, no telephone to call and ask. The distance were far between him and Imam Hassan. And then he told him, there is 1 million dirham I give you, 500,000 now. You come to my side and then I will give you another 500,000. Now he thought, okay, 500,000 dirham is a huge money. And maybe Imam Hassan will accept peace of treaty. So he and 12,000 of the soldiers of Imam Hassan, they moved toward Muawiyah and they joined Muawiyah. Next day, the army was awake and he see that their leader is not there. Qais ibn Sa'd ibn Abada was another sincere and honest Shia, very brave, very pious, very sincere. When he knew what Ubaydullah ibn al-Abbas did, he told the people, don't care for him because he is really without honor. When he knew Muawiyah sent Basr ibn Artat and killed his two children, still without shame, he leave his imam and join Muawiyah. So don't think about that, and you be strong in your faith. And then they fought very bravely and they defeated the army of Muawiyah. I mean, they said the front army, not all the army, still army of Imam Hassan completely did not reach, you know. They send usually 10, 15,000 first from both sides, they fight, till rest of the army will come, let us say 60, 70,000 each side, they will join later on. But first they said Muqaddima, the, let us say preliminary army or introduction of the army, so 10, 15,000 will go first, you know. However, when Imam Hassan alayhi salam moved with his army till Madain and it came near border of Syria and Iraq, border of today, you know, then Muawiyah sent a lot of money to many leaders and told them, why do you fight? You know, you come with me. And they say, Imam Hassan is sending me letters and he wants to make peace with me. So you fight for nothing, then ultimately you lose. If I sign peace treaty with him, then you are enemy. Well, many people were not really religious. Some of them were not really loving Imam Hassan, but they have to fight because Iraq against Syria, not because that is his country. Not that he believed of about imamate of Imam Hassan. Many of them were Kharijis, for example. They hate Imam Hassan and hate Imam Ali alayhi salam. And though they hate Muawiyah as well, but they were not in good terms with Imam Hassan alayhi salam. And then Muawiyah sent people to negotiate with Imam Hassan, three people. When they came out of the tent, they told the army that thanks God, the situation is coming into peace and there is a peace treaty between Hassan and Muawiyah. This is very good. May Allah bless everybody. So what the people thought that Imam Hassan accepted the offer of Muawiyah, and with all intelligence and views of the intelligence among the army of Imam Hassan, so the people get a confusion that, oh, Imam Hassan is negotiating with Muawiyah and they are fighting. They're fighting for what? Why to be killed, you know? So unfortunately, some of them came and attacked Imam Hassan in his tent and they injured his thigh and, well, throw the tent above him and took his prayer rug from below him. So Imam Hassan felt threat from the people and he got sick. And he asked the tribe of Hamdan, they were very honest tribe, to protect him and to surround him. And then from the injury he had, he got very sick, and then most of his army were dispersed. Now Imam Hassan found that if he fight, then only the sincere believers and the sincere people among Bani Hashim will be killed. You know, Imam Hassan will not be killed unless other Bani Hashim, Imam Hussein and other Bani Hashim, naturally they will defend their Imam, and all will be killed before Imam Hassan. And then they will not be killed unless all the sincere and honest, real sincere Shias will be killed. And even if they were killed, they will not mind to be martyred in this for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But what benefit they are going to gain? The propaganda of Muawiyah is so strong that he will say, well, I have sent a letter to Hassan that, okay, you rule and we are with you, we are your ministers. But he rejected that. He wanted only to fight with us. He wanted to kill us. So we had no option except to kill him. Otherwise, we want him to be the caliph. Not that we refuse that. But at least we told him, we will be your minister, and that. And naturally the people will believe, and his martyrdom will not have its effect. It is not like martyrdom of Imam Hussein alayhi salam in Karbala, which was planned very well, and then Yazid was not so clever like Muawiyah to have a propaganda among the people and change mind of the people. Well, besides that, the situation has changed a lot, and the people realize what a cruel man Muawiyah and Bani Umayyah are. I mean, that is after peace treaty of Imam Hassan alayhi salam, which he was forced to sign it with Muawiyah. Then Muawiyah was exposed in mind of the people that he is not really religious, he's a cruel man, and he is the man who like only worldly life and like the power. He doesn't care for religion at all. Because Muawiyah, after having signing peace treaty with Imam Hassan, and Imam Hassan put conditions that first of all the Shias has to be in safety, no one to be killed or to be harassed at all, and he has to look after the orphans and widows who were killed in battles of Siffin and Nahrawan and Kamil, the followers of Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam. And also he has to practice according to Quran and Sunnah, and all those conditions were put in the peace treaty. But then Muawiyah, first time when he reached to Nukhayla near Kufa, he delivered a sermon. First he abused Imam Ali alayhi salam and Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein in front of people. When Imam Hussein replied him that, "Oh Muawiyah, my father is Ali, your father is Abu Sufyan, and my mother is Fatima al-Zahra, your mother is Hind, and my grandfather is Rasulullah, your grandfather is Abu Sufyan. So may Allah curse the lowest one among us." The people said Ameen, and all they said Ameen. The lowest one naturally is Muawiyah and his mother Hind and his father Abu Sufyan. However, you know, from the very beginning, he did not honor the conditions of the peace treaty. And he declared frankly in front of people, "O people of Iraq, I did not fight with you in order to pray or to fast or to go for Hajj or to pay Zakat. I know you are doing that. I fought with you in order to be your ruler, to be your king. I am ruler. And now Allah gave me that. Any condition I gave it to Hassan ibn Ali, it is under my feet." So right away he said, "All those conditions, I will not honor them." Naturally, the people realized that what he used to say, that, "Well, I need to protect religion and I need Islam to flourish and develop, and we are religious," all that is just for bluffing the people. Otherwise, his main aim is to be the governor of the Muslim countries. However, later on, he appointed Ziyad ibn Utbah or Ziyad ibn Abi as a ruler of Iraq. And Ziyad killed thousands of the Shias because he knew them from time of Imam Ali alayhi salam. And he used to kill the people and destroy their houses. So even their family will suffer. I mean, his wife and children will suffer. There is no shelter for them. He will not give them their salary from Baytul Mal. And he destroyed their houses, demolished their houses, and killed the father. So naturally, the mother and the children will remain in the street without any shelter, without food. So that cruel situation were done, and then thousands of people were killed after that. Well, because of mockery of Muawiyah, Imam Hassan could not fight the people. We're not realizing where is right, where is wrong, you know. So that is why they did not support him. And after that, he migrated to Medina. And he lived till the year 50, and that was the year of his martyrdom. So that is about the peace treaty of Imam Hassan and the reasons for it and the effect of it, the future effect. It is actually to expose Muawiyah. So that is a preliminary step for the great revolution of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. So the people know Bani Umayyah are not religious, are very bad, are thinking of their worldly life. They do not care for religion. And that fact was clear in mind of people after peace treaty of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Another point in life of Imam Hassan mentioned, that is his polygamy or multiple marriage. Well, to marry 4, 5, 6, 10, at that time it was normal, you know. Some wives get dead and he married others. Well, because wars, you know, killed thousands of people, so many girls remains without marriage, and it was very normal to marry in all life, I mean, to not at one time, maximum 4. But when they die, one marry others, so in his life, maybe 10 maximum, for example. That is, was normal situation at that time. But it is mentioned that he married 70 wives. Another one mentioned, no, 250 wives. A third one, he mentioned, no, he had 300 wives. And then some historians are criticizing Imam Hassan that his aim was not to fight. He was not a brave man. And he was enjoying only to marry so many wives. You marry one wife today and he divorce her tomorrow, and marry another one and divorce her the after tomorrow, and so on. So that was his job. Actually, these are fake hadith and not true, because they were mentioned by Madaini. Madaini, first of all, was known that he was not trustworthy in saying the hadith. And secondly, he was against Ahlul Bayt, Salamullahi Alayhim. And thirdly, he used to write this to enjoy Bani Umayyah, and after them, Bani al-Abbas. Because at the time of Abbasis, at the time of Mansur al-Dawaniqi, those who were fighting against Abbasis were descendants of Imam Hassan alayhi salam. They called the Hassanis. Abdullah ibn al-Hassan and others, they were the fighters. So Mansur al-Dawaniqi, in his sermon, when he killed Abdullah ibn al-Hassan, he said, this man is descendant of his father, Hassan ibn Ali, who had so many wives. He enjoyed that, and he surrendered to Muawiyah. He did not fight, and he used to care only for whatever money he gets, and that is all, you know. So you see, Bani al-Abbas propagated that idea. And it is mentioned in three books, actually. One of them is by the Madaini. We said Madaini, the narrators of hadith, they said he is not trustworthy, and what he writes is not correct, you know. A lot of things are not correct. The second one is the Qanduzi, who write it without telling who are the narrators of that, without narration. He said it was like that. Then who said and related to whom? The chain of narrators is not there. So naturally that hadith has no value when you don't know the chain of narrators. And the third one who write about it, Abu Talib al-Makki, and he write it also without mentioning who are the narrators, because he lived in the year 280 after Hijrah, while Imam Hassan was martyred at the year 50. So 200 years after Imam Hassan, he wrote that. But he hear that from whom is not mentioned, you know. So you see that these are not really trustworthy hadith. First of all, none of the imams have that number of wives. As I said, 4, 5, 6 to 10, 12, that was normal at that time. Zubair had, others had. The Holy Prophet had totally more than 10 wives. You know, 9 it was, there were at a time, but total, those who were divorced or died, they were total about 14. So in those days, that number was normal. But number 70 or 250 or 300 was abnormal number. Especially when they add stories about it, that Imam Ali alayhi salam came and he said, don't give your daughters to my son, because my son will divorce them, and I will be ashamed with the people that their daughters are divorced. And one of the Muslims replied, they said, no, Ya Ali, we don't care. We will be son-in-law of the Prophet. We give our daughter even for one night. If Imam Hassan marry them, we don't mind. So we give our daughters even for one night, and then let him divorce them. That is an honor for us that our daughter was son-in-law of the Prophet. So these stories are all fake stories, not true. First of all, Imam Ali will not criticize Imam Hassan. And if Imam Hassan knew that was wrong, he would not have done it. If it is right, then Imam Ali will not criticize something right, you know. So all those are, as I said, fake stories made by historians who are pro-Bani Umayyah and later on pro-Bani al-Abbas. Because we don't see in the writing between Muawiyah and Imam Hassan anything mentioned about that. If that was there, then Muawiyah could have written to Imam Hassan that, oh, your personality is very weak and you are a man of womanizing. Every day you marry one and divorce her tomorrow, so what personality you are? But nothing mentioned like that at the time of Muawiyah. So naturally, it was not a fact. It was cooked later on to abuse and criticize Imam Hassan alayhi salam. Beside that, if he would have 70 or 250 or 300 women, at least the tribes will be honored. They said, well, our daughter was wife of grandson of the Prophet. Who are those wives? There is no mention in the history about them. Whatever mentioned is about 10 wives. And the children of Imam Hassan are only maximum, say, 10 sons and 5 daughters, maximum mentioned. Some said less than that. So if that is the only number, so how can he have 300 wives and then there are no children from them? So you see, all these are suggesting that these are fake hadith just to abuse the grandson of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that also because his descendants were the one who were good fighters against the tyranny of Bani Umayyah and Bani al-Abbas. So that is mentioned about Imam Hassan, however, to be known. Well, Imam Hassan lived in Medina after that. He was very generous and he used to go for Hajj walking with barefooted, you know. 25 times he went from Medina to Mecca walking for Hajj. And he had the camels and horses are with him, but he was not riding. He said, I have to show myself in situation of a humiliation in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Well, he was very generous and he was protecting actually the honor of the needy and poor people. One day a man came to the door of Imam Hassan alayhi salam, and from behind the door, before knocking the door, you know, the wall was not very high, so if somebody called from outside, the people inside the house, they can hear him. The wall was not very high in those days. So he recited two poetry praising Imam Hassan, and he said, well, we came to you and we want to sell our honor to you. Because you see, asking people is type of a humiliation, so your honor will be reduced. So he say, my honor, I want to sell it to whom? To you, because you are a generous man. So Imam Hassan alayhi salam opened the door half, did not open it completely, and gave him a big amount of money and recited two poetry in reply of him. He said, take this money and make yourself as you have not sold your honor and as we have not purchased it. Keep your honor for yourself. And even did not see him, so that the humiliation of question, somebody is asking, naturally he feels small, that will not, without seeing him, he just opened the door little and gave him the money and closed the door, so that he will not see who is the man, and the man will feel that his honor was protected. I mean, up to this much, Imam used to protect honor of the people. It is mentioned one day Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein and Abdullah ibn Ja'far, son of Ja'far al-Tayyar, his cousin of Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein, and his husband of Sayyidah Zainab salamullah alayha. They came back from Mecca and it looks they were alone. There was no caravan with them. They were very hungry and reached a tent. There was an old lady there and asked her if she has any food or any drink. She said, no water and no food. I have only one goat. You take the milk of that to drink it, and then you slaughter that goat, and that is your food. you make your food. You are men, you can do it, you know. Her husband was not there in that desert. And well, they first got the milk of the goat to drink it, and then they slaughtered the goat and made food and told her that we are people from Medina. If you like, you come to Medina and we will help you. Then they went to Mecca and then returned back to Medina. When the husband of that old lady came and he asked, where is our goat? She told him that an honorable people came and they asked me, and they are our guest, that we had nothing to serve them except that goat, and they slaughtered that goat. And they told me, we are honorable man of Medina. You come to Medina, we'll help you. So after some time, they had no money. You see, in the desert, maybe little cultivation, and sometimes there is no rain, and it become a famine. So he came with his wife to Medina. The holy city of Medina was a big city comparing to the desert around it. And then Imam Hassan saw her in the street, and he called her with her husband to his house and gave her 1,000 dinar and 1,000 goat. And then sent her to his brother Imam Hussein and told him that she is the woman who served us when we were in the desert. Imam Hussein alayhi salam also gave her 1,000 goat and 1,000 dinar and sent her to Abdullah ibn Ja'far. Abdullah ibn Ja'far gave her the same. When she returned back with 3,000 goats and 3,000 dinar, that was a huge money for her tribe, with great honor that this is from the grandson of the Prophet. Naturally, it is generosity of Imam Hassan alayhi salam. And not only that, Imam Hassan give it to people who are honorable people, who are generous. Because you know, if they have that amount of money and food in the way to Mecca, they will serve always the people who go for pilgrimage to Mecca. See, in those days, you don't have like service areas of today. You get food or a drink or a coffee. Well, in the roads, there was no such facilities. And when the people move in desert, sometimes they get thirst, sometimes they need food, and nobody is there to serve them except the generous people. So when Imam knew that she is generous, and that family are respected, said, okay, if they are rich, they will give all that money to others and distribute it among the tribe and among the people who are needy and cross in that road. So though he is generous, but again, that generosity is counted for benefit of the people. He has the gut to give all that and also to think about the benefit of the Muslims. However, Muawiyah could not tolerate that Imam Hassan is in Medina. The people like him, see his honor, see his respect, his ahadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he sent to the Roman emperor that I need a very killing poison so that I kill son of the Prophet. Well, the Roman emperor, he told him, killing people by poison is not accepted in our faith. So why do you want that poison? Then Muawiyah told him, well, no, I want to kill a grandson of the Prophet who brought Islam and changed the area, Arabia, into a Muslim area. And then, well, he sent him the poison, and Muawiyah gave that poison to wife of Imam Hassan, Ju'da bintul Ash'ath, daughter of Ash'ath ibn Qais, and promised her if she kill Imam Hassan, we'll give her money. She put the poison in, let us say, milk, and it looks, he was poisoned many times, till the last day when the poison was very severe. Imam Hassan alayhi salam was very sick at home. Imam Hussein came to visit him and told him, oh, my brother, tell me, who has poisoned you? Imam Hassan said, what are you going to do? If the one whom I think has poisoned me is the same, then Allah will take revenge from him. I mean, he did not want to tell him that my wife poisoned me, because he said you cannot kill a woman, you know, in that case. So better keep it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then suddenly Imam Hassan was vomiting, and he vomited clotted blood from his belly, because poison had affected him, and his face was very yellow. At that situation, Sayyida Zainab salamullah alayha also knocked the door to enter the room to see her brothers Hassan and Hussein. Imam Hassan told her to cover the container so that Zainab should not see the blood. She came and she saw her brother is very yellowish. It shows that he has bleeded a lot, and his pale face. And she asked him that, is he feeling very sick? And then she noticed a side where there is a blood. She was very much annoyed that her brother is so much sick, and he was talking to him when, well, he told her that, oh, my sister, you are going to see more bloods in Karbala, where not only this little blood that you see, but much more than that will be there. Then when Imam Hassan, salamullahi alayh, was at the time of death, he told his brother Imam Hussein that if they allow you, if Bani Umayyah and Aisha allow you, you bury me beside my grandfather, the Holy Prophet. And if they refuse, do not fight with the people. Bury me near my grandmother Fatima bint Asad, mother of Imam Ali alayhi salam, in Baqi'. And when Imam Hussein and Bani Hashim brought the coffin to visit the Holy Prophet, Bani Umayyah came and Aisha was there, and she said, I hate that you bury Hassan beside his grandfather. This is my house and I do not allow that. And then Bani Umayyah were ready to fight. They had arrows and they threw the janazah of Imam Hassan alayhi salam with arrow. It is mentioned more than 70 arrows hit the janazah. Abu al-Fadl was standing there, Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. He took his sword out to fight when Imam Hussein looked to him and said, oh brother, what are you doing? He said, don't you see them? They are throwing arrow to the coffin of my brother. He said, no, this is not your time. You have a time in Karbala to fight. But my brother Imam Hassan told me not to have even a drop of bloodshed in my case. So he told them that I want only to visit the grave of my grandfather and I will bury him in Baqi'. And then he came and buried Imam Hassan alayhi salam in Baqi'. إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ وَسَيَعْلَمُ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا أَيَّ مُنْقَلَبٍ يَنْقَلِبُونَ وَالْعَاقِبَةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد اللهم بحق محمد وأهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وبمظلومية الإمام الحسن عليه السلام عجل فرج وليك صاحب العصر والزمان واجعلنا من أنصاره وأعوانه ومن المجاهدين بين يديه اللهم اقض بهم حوائجنا واشف بهم مرضانا وارحم بهم موتانا واغفر بهم ذنوبنا ويسر بهم مطالبنا وارزقنا بهم من فضلك خير الدنيا والآخرة والحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على محمد وآله الطاهرين اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد